Analysis of Chapter 1, Harry Potter and the Philosopher's Stone, The Boy Who Lived. Harry Potter enters the story when he is brought to the most seemingly normal family in all Britain, the Dursleys. Not only are they normal, they are apparently also quite mundane, boring, and averse to anything even remotely out of the ordinary in their dull, routine lives, though there may be a particular reason for some of their behavior. Only gradually do readers become aware that a magical world populated by witches and wizards secretly coexists alongside non-magical humans, known as Muggles. The odd characters wandering the streets dressed in rather outlandish clothing are the first hint to this hidden society. Little is revealed about what has recently happened, though it has created some noticeable activity that has spilled over into the Muggle world. The scar on baby Harry's forehead will clearly be a lasting reminder that sinister events must have occurred, resulting in the infant being orphaned. Dumbledore's, McGonagall's, and Hagrid's actions lead us to believe that Harry is far more special than a mere orphan needing a home, though little is explained here. And while Professor Dumbledore does leave a letter with the infant, presumably explaining everything to the Dursleys, whatever information it contains is withheld, for now, from readers. We, like Harry, will gradually discover what has transpired and learn about this remarkable hidden world in small bits, though this chapter's title, The Boy Who Lived, in addition to baby Harry's scar, indicates he must have had some near-fatal experience. Judging by Vernon Dursley's behavior, he may already know more about this hidden world than readers are initially led to believe. The conversation between Minerva McGonagall and Albus Dumbledore in this chapter is designed to bring several points of information to the reader without having to explicitly state them. One of the basic tenets of writing is show, don't tell, which can make it difficult to illuminate backstory that is necessary to understanding. In particular, we need to know of the existence of Voldemort, and of his downfall, and this is communicated to us by this conversation. We also need to know that there is a reason for Dumbledore's placing Harry with his relatives, and the conversation is also tailored to inform us that there is a reason, but that it is not to be divulged just yet. Additionally, this conversation establishes the character of both McGonagall and Dumbledore, and the relationship between them, as director and trusted aide. The student could well profit by study of this one short interaction and all that it tells us. Other commentators have noted that the author is very strong in what is called the setup and payoff, creating a situation, then suddenly resolving it. Sometimes the setup and payoff are contained in a single chapter, other times they span multiple chapters or even multiple books. This chapter, in fact, is one example of a setup, the list of strange things that occur in the vicinity of the Dursleys, and the discovery that they are connected to the Dursley family, and payoff, revelation of the reason for the events and the arrival of the infant Harry. Students are encouraged to examine the work for set ups and payoffs, and determine how they enhance the holding power of the book and of the series as a whole. We will note that while the setup and payoff is a staple of writing for the film industry, the Harry Potter films are not as rich in this as the books. We believe this is because of the amount of material that must be elided from a novel to fit into 2 hours of film. In order to keep the necessary story elements, some of the less important setup events had to be dropped. We will learn about the wizarding world through Harry's eyes. In the entire series there are only 5 chapters, including this one, that are written apart from his point of view. These chapters are at each book's beginning, and provides us information that is still unknown to Harry. The other chapters are, Chapter 1 of Harry Potter and the Goblet of Fire, Chapter 1 and Chapter 2 of Harry Potter and the Half-Blood Prince, and Chapter 1 of Harry Potter and the Deathly Hallows. These are the only times readers are privy to information that Harry is not. Generally, we see events only when and how Harry experiences them. Evidence indicates that Harry was born on July 31, 1980, and orphaned on October 31, 1981 Halloween night when he is 1 year and 3 months old. Critics point out a lack of trick-or-treating and similar festivities on Privet Drive that night, but it should be mentioned that we never actually see Privet Drive on the 31st, it is the 1st of November when Vernon Dursley leaves for work, and later that same night when Dumbledore, McGonagall, and Hagrid arrive. Evidence also suggests that there is a day between when Harry's parents died, and his arrival at Privet Drive. Harry is orphaned on October 31, 1981. And the story opens with Vernon Dursley leaving for work on the morning of November 1st. This has sparked speculation amongst readers, is there an accident of dates, or is the missing day a purposeful addition by the author? It was believed by many readers that the occurrences during that day would be important, possibly even pivotal, to events in the seventh book. There is also a contradiction: November 1, 1981 was, in reality, a Sunday, and the book states that that day is a Tuesday. There are similar minor internal conflicts throughout the series. These errors or oversights do not detract from the sweep of the story, so while they may be mentioned, they are provided more as a curiosity than as something for the readers to concern themselves with. Readers should also note the TV news reports about flying owls being spotted during daylight. This is an early reference to the Wizarding World's owl postal system. Voldemort's death likely prompted a huge flurry of wizard mail being carried by owls, which was noticed by Muggles.